everybody. Joe Diesel here.
And this is Jesse.
And Jesse is with us this week. Hey, Jesse, what happened to you last week?
I was abducted by aliens.
You what?
I said I was abducted by aliens.
Oh, were you probed?
That's none of your business, Miss. That's between me and my alien above Paris and a UFO. Having a great time? That's between us, Mister. Get on with the show.
Well, all right. On that note, we will get on with the show. So let's look at the box office last week. What do you think was number one last weekend?
Number one. Wow. Was it Transformers again?
Oh, no, no. No Transformers this week.
Oh, really? Huh. I don't even know what came out last week. What came out last week, Joe?
Dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
Oh, yeah, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. Yeah, that had to be number one.
That is number one.
Had to be.
And number two is Transformers. So do you have a guess at number three?
22 Jump Street?
Number three, Tammy. So, and you just named
it.
Number four, the 22 Jump Street. So, what do you think is number five?
How to Train Your Dragon?
Yep, How to Train Your Dragon. That's right.
Good guess.
So, that rounds up the top five. So, the movie we are going to do this week, which I was sick for the week we were... It opened, and I couldn't see it then. So that is Deliver Us from Evil. That is, for last weekend, that is at number seven. So it's in the top ten here, 2 weeks into its release. So feeling better, so we see it. So let's talk a little bit. This is another one of those supernatural horror movies inspired by actual accounts. On the movie posters, it says, inspired by actual accounts of an NYPD sergeant. So when you saw the trailer for this, what did you think? Did you want to see it right away? Did you have to look at the trailer a couple of times before you're like, yeah, I'll see that? Because I know earlier in the year there was that, we went and saw that. I can't even remember the name of it now. What was that found footage horror movie we watched there in January?
Not The Chosen Ones. Is it The Chosen Ones? No.
No, the one before
the Quiet
Ones.
No.
The one before The Quiet Ones.
Wow.
I can't even remember its name. But anyway,
yeah.
Devils Do, yeah, it had some of the same types of in terms of demons and stuff like that.
Right.
So what did you think about the trailers when you first saw them?
I didn't think it looked bad. I thought it looked like what's the word I'm looking here for, Joe? It looked
intriguing.
Fairly plain. It wasn't. It didn't look like it was going to be something hugely exciting. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it didn't look exceptional.
It didn't look exceptional. I just thought it was going to be a fun movie about about demons.
A fun movie about demons.
Yeah. You know me. The horror movies.
A fun movie about demons is Night of the Demons.
Yeah. I mean, they're fun movies. I have fun watching them because it's. Most time they're rather, I like to be scared. It doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, me too. I know what you mean. I thought the same thing. One of the things that sort of came to my mind when I saw that was the Clive Barker character, Harry D'Amore, who is always investigating supernatural things, and he appeared in one movie, underrated Lord of Illusions, played by Scott Bakula. That sort of reminded me of that. I know they're not the same. He's a PI and all that stuff. But, you know, I'm just sort of like, wow, it looks like something Clive Barker might write. But
yeah,
it's inspired by actual events. And there is a book out by the policeman, Ralph Sarchi. Is that how you say his name?
Yes, it is, sir.
Sarchi, and co-authored by Lisa Coulier Cool.
Yep.
And that is called Beware the Night, which I kind of like that title better. I kind of wish they had kept that title. Originally, that was going to be the title of the movie, but they just changed it. After seeing the movie, I definitely really want to read the book. I wanted to read the book before, but after having seen the movie, I want to read it more.
Yeah. I got to admit, I was, whenever they say true story, you know, this is based on a true story, I'm usually a little bit more interested, but I'm usually kind of turned off when it says inspired by a true story. You know what I mean? Because inspired means they're going to change it to what they like. It's going to be, you know, basically a, they're just going to use it as inspiration. They're not actually going to tell the story as it should be told, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean, because a lot of times the stuff they take out of the true story is more interesting than what they make up.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
what they put in there. So let's say, well, what do you think about the movie itself before we really dig into it?
I thought the movie was quite well done. It's not a bad movie. It's just, it feels so incomplete. I think that's the main problem with it. It doesn't cohese as well as it should. I can't say anything hugely horrible about it. It's an okay movie, but it has a lot of problems, but it has a lot of good stuff, too. I think the best thing in the movie, and I don't know if you'll agree with this or not, but I really did enjoy the performance by Eric Bana in the film. I thought he was pretty fabulous in it. I enjoyed Joel McHale in it as the his partner. And the other actor, help me out here, Joe. What was the name of the guy who played the priest? Help me out.
That is Edgar Ramirez.
Edgar Ramirez was quite good in the movie. And even the lady who, Olivia Munn, who's most famous for being the host of a show about entertainment, wasn't too bad in it.
Yeah, I agree with that. I like the cast. Eric Bana did a great job with this, and so did the rest of the cast. I liked the cast in this.
Yeah.
And I agree with what you were saying for the most part. You're watching it, it's like this. I was thinking, well, this is pretty good, but then you do think, well, maybe it could have been a lot better because, yeah, it didn't cohese as well as it should have. I totally agree with that.
Yeah. Well, since it's based on a real person, Ralph Sarchi, you would think that it would be more based on things he did in real life, you know what I mean, and cases he actually worked. But the movie is, wow, it seems like it's a... what's the word I'm looking for, Joe? It's so hard to find.
We were saying it seemed like an origin movie for him doing what he called the work.
Right.
And in the movie, the priest talks to him about that and says, you've been called to the work.
Right.
But, it's kind of interesting. Ralph Sarchi actually did work on the movie. He was a consultant for the police aspects of the movie. He didn't really consult with the supernatural aspects of the movie. One of the other things, and if we haven't said it yet, and just in case any of the listeners never listened before, we are going to give away spoilers in case you haven't seen this yet.
Mm-hmm.
So if you haven't seen it yet, then pause this and listen to it after you've seen it. But there was that one scene that we were wondering about, the scene where, now I'll just set this up real quick. He encounters some cops, and they go, oh, you're the guy that brought down, I forget the guy's name. Marvin? Marty?
Marvin Molester, yeah.
Marvin, okay. Oh, yeah, that was some good work when you brought him down. Well, then they actually show him, bring him down, because he's talking to the priest about that. And what he does, you know, I thought that he brought him down through some detective work, some police work. Well, he didn't. He just chased him down and beat him to death until he died.
Yeah.
And we're like, well, how did he get off on that? Because he wasn't even on duty for that. He was just out, and there was the crime scene, and he, you know, he was a cop, so he got access and look around. And of course, sometimes the killers like to go back to the crime scene, and he saw him there gawking, chasing down Peter the Pope. Well, they don't explain how he got off on that, how he got away with that. And, you know, that was one of the things you and I were talking about. I was like, well, how do you get away with that? Because I just don't see how he could have gotten away with it.
Right.
So what do you think about that?
Well, I thought that was one of the stupider parts of the movie because, for one thing, he even says that what he did was wrong. He knows what he did was wrong, but what he did was murder. He murdered that guy. But everybody knows he murdered that guy. You know, they didn't show you, like, him trying to frame the guy by putting a gun on him or something like that. He didn't even shoot the guy. He beat the guy to death with his bare hands.
Yeah, he couldn't talk his way out of it, couldn't do anything out of it.
Yeah.
The interesting thing about that was when he's talking to the priest about that, I thought that was good when they had him talking to the priest about it, but I do think they should have explained how he got out of it legally.
Right.
But I did see an interview with Ralph Sarchi, and he said he never did anything like that.
Yeah.
He never beat anybody to death, but as he read the script, he was going, well, this really is a work of fiction. And I know they're trying to do character arc, so he just looked at it that way, and he just kind of let it go. But I felt they could have done a little bit better with that aspect.
Yeah, I agree, because it wasn't even adding to his character either. I mean, he basically just murdered the guy because he didn't like what that guy did. He's like, I don't like child molesters. Well, no one likes child molesters. You know, it doesn't really help him on his arc to who he was trying to be, you know. He was a good cop. Him and his partner were called, at one point, they called him the Special Forces, because they were the ones who came in and did all the, like, weird stuff, I guess. Because at the beginning of the movie, they're called to the Bronx Zoo to take care of a guy who's in the lion cage. Or not the lion cage, it's the lady who threw her baby over into the lion cage, correct? Isn't that right?
Yeah, she threw it into the moat right before the lion cage.
And so that leads you to she's one of the people who are possessed by this demon that these soldiers find in Iraq. My problem with the movie, though, is it seems like it should be a character study, and it's not. It's more of a cop police procedural film with supernatural elements. The stuff that he did that you and I would call, he called the work, he actually did outside of the police force. He wasn't really, you know, doing that on the job, per se. That was something that he did on his own, when he was off the clock. So, but it's a plot-based movie. It's a hugely plot-based movie. When, honestly, it shouldn't be. It should be a character study of why this guy does the work he does. Which he, you know, he, knows is weird. He knows it's not a normal job, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
In the movie, like I said, it seems like a superhero origin. But it's like, this is how he decided that he wanted to be, you know, a good cop or something like, you know, how he wanted to be a demon hunter or demonologist, which is what his actual term is, what he does.
We'll get back into it right after the break, but we're up here against the break here, so we'll see what's going on. Your daughter is possessed by a demon that's been dwelling out of your house for millennia. You don't know what to do. Well, you better call Deliver Us from Evil Movers. We'll get the hell in there and get you and your possessions the hell out. The only possession that we leave behind will be your daughter, because let's face it, she's as good as gone. That's right. We don't fight evil. We get you as far away as possible. We've helped people through countless situations. You have ghosts that are trying to scare you out or suck your daughter into a TV? You can stay and fight, or you can just sell the house and move. We also specialize in selling these haunted places. Why sacrifice any more of your loved ones to crazed killers in the attic or evil fairies coming out of the basement? There's only one thing for you to do, and that is get out of that house. You shouldn't have to fight the forces of evil. You should have the right to tuck your head and run. Lick your wounds someplace safe and mourn your losses. You'll be alive, and that's all that matters. So call us at 976-EVIL. Deliver us from evil movers. We get the hell in so you can get the hell out. Warning, we are not Ghostbusters, demon hunters, or monster destroyers. If moving you out risks our lives, our backs will turn yellow, and we will abandon you, and we will not apologize for it. All right, we are back. Hey, Jesse.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just want to apologize for making you angry earlier.
It's all right. You know, those stupid aliens. He told me he loved me, Joe.
All right, let's get on with the show on that note. We're talking a little bit about the work that he did. Now, his partner called a certain sense that he had, he called it his radar.
His radar, yeah.
And he would just listen for cases, and then they would, he had this sense about him that drew him to it. That just drew him to the thing, and that's what the priest called it. He said, you're just drawn to it. You have this gift. Well, that makes you susceptible, and that makes your family targets of these demonic forces. So I thought that was interesting. His talking to the priest. I thought their treatment of religion in this was nice. A lot of the times, and not every time, but a lot of the times they'll be. You know, just sort of brushed off, and they don't want to deal with the religious aspects. They just want to deal with the fantastical demon aspects, but they don't want to deal with the spiritual aspects. I thought they did a good job in doing those in this movie. What did you think about that?
I thought they handled, weirdly enough, I thought they handled the Catholic religion with some respect. It was very respectful of the religion, which I thought, you know, I was pretty amazed by, actually. So, most movies now they kind of turn their noses up at the Catholic, you know, Catholic religion and all that. So, I was quite happy to see that.
Ralph Soci is a devout Catholic, right?
Right, he is a devout Catholic in real life. Yes.
He's not depicted that way at the beginning of the movie, but he ends that way at the end of the movie.
In fact, in the movie, he says that he outgrew God when he was 12, was the way they put it, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think the priest said that to him. Well, how do you outgrow God? And what I thought was interesting was the priest says, hey, I have these flaws and these flaws. This is what I did, and I've fallen, and I've done this. And,
yeah.
Opens up to Ralph, and they get a sense of understanding of each other and a trust of each other, which I thought they portrayed really well in the movie.
Yeah, I thought that the relationship was quite good. I could see how they got along together, because at first they didn't get along at all, which, you know, kind of like that buddy cop movie, you know, and all that good stuff, but. They when he finally came to understand this is not normal day activity. You know, this isn't some guy who's just crazy. This is some guy who has got a demon in him. The movie really embraced the Catholicism. One of the things I liked is that Eric Bana made that joke about when the priest looks at that woman's butt. And he says, "I see you're not a pedophile." And the priest says, "Do you have any other cliche for me or something like that or any other stereotypes?" Which I thought was just right, you know. Because that has become such a cliche that every Catholic priest in the movie has to have some kind of sexual attraction to children. It's ridiculous, you know. So I was quite happy to see that scene in the movie, hear that line in the movie.
Yeah, they did a good job with the going back and forth of that and dealing with that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That has become so, as you said, cliche now. It's just so easy just to do that joke right away. That's just the first joke that you can think. It's just so easy to go straight to that. Now, well, let's talk a little bit about, I know you don't like the director that much, but this was directed by Scott Derrickson.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched a few of his movies. Let's see, I'm looking at the list of what he's got here. He actually directed a Hellraiser movie. I did not know that. I don't think I've seen that one. Hellraiser Inferno.
That sucks.
I think that was his first feature. I'm not sure that I've seen that. I might just go check it just out of curiosity. But I think his first wide release was The Exorcism of Emily Rose.
Yeah.
And
which
I know
think it's a very good movie.
You love that movie.
Oh,
with all
that's
your
a horrible,
heart.
Horrible movie.
Yeah, I liked it a little more than you did, but I do know that it could have been better. Now, his next one, The Day the Earth Stood Still, I couldn't stand at all.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
It's tippy-dippy. I tried to watch it, tippy-dippy.
Yeah, then his next one, Sinister, I thought was pretty good.
Sinister's not bad. I'll give you Sinister. Sinister's not bad. But Sinister seems to be a movie that's a direct, what am I looking for? It was like, hey, Insidious did really, really well. Let's make other movies like Insidious, you know? And that's how it seemed to be, you know? It wasn't any kind of any great work done by anybody.
Yeah, it was, I thought that was pretty good, too. And now, you know, that brings us to Deliverance from Evil, and then Announced is Doctor Strange.
Right.
Which I never really read Doctor Strange, so I don't really know.
Yeah. I like Doctor Strange as a character. I do think that he's a cool character. But, I mean, his own character, it blends well the way he does, which is the supernatural stuff and stuff like that, and like I just wonder because he seems to have a preoccupation with Catholicism because Emily Rose revolved a lot around Catholicism, and I just wonder how he's going to handle Doctor Strange. Here's the thing, here's where he's lucky at if he's going to do the Doctor Strange movie more than any other director. And that's that nobody cares about Dr. Strange. No one, you know, invests their hearts and souls into Dr. Strange. He can do whatever he wants with it. He can change it any way he wants, and no one's going to care. And you and I both know that.
Yeah.
So he got a little bit lucky there.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
This movie here has a, you know, sort of a thin connection to The Conjuring, doesn't it?
Very thin. Actually, I wouldn't say that thin. Mr. Sarcy has worked with the Warrens before. In fact, he worked with them on a couple of their cases, him and his partner, who is Mr. Joe Mendoza, the preacher. So, they both been in that world. That should be the next movie, I think, in both series. It should be The Willows and The Conjuring with the Warrens and Ralph Fiennes.
That would be interesting. That would be cool. Now, we got to mention this. This movie does have an exorcism in it. And obviously the movie that everybody, if you got an exorcism in your movie, the first movie that you are compared to automatically is The Exorcist. Am I right?
Right.
So how do you think the exorcism in this movie, do you think this was well done? Was it different enough? Do you think they copied The Exorcist, or what do you think?
Here's the thing. The Exorcist thing in this movie, if you watch The Exorcist and then you watch this movie, The Exorcist looks 10 times more realistic now. Because that was outlandish. It was really, really outlandish, the exorcism scene in that movie. Because he busts out windows and the rain comes pouring in.
Yeah.
And he's breaking bones, you know, like stretching out his neck and everything like that. The exorcist scene is much more subtle, which is also, you know, that's a weird thing to say, you know.
It's weird, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. How subtle. But, you know, what can you do?
Yeah, I thought they did a good job on this exorcist scene, on this one.
Mm-hmm.
So now I do want to mention this because there was another movie not that long ago about a priest who did exorcisms, which was based on a book, a real Catholic priest, and that was called The Rite with Anthony Hopkins. Did you see that one?
I did not see that one.
Now, I did see that one. I thought it was very poorly done. I haven't read that book, and I wanted to read that book after I saw the movie, and I knew about the book before the movie. You build up this queue of books, and you you slowly whittle them down. But I thought this was a lot better than that one.
Mm-hmm.
So if you ever check that one out, then there's a few exorcism scenes in that one. But that one didn't come together at all. So this one is a masterpiece compared to that one.
I think when we were talking after the movie was over that the thing that the movie reminded me of was Apparition, which is a British TV show about a Catholic priest. He's the church's exorcist. He's the one that the church goes to when they want to perform exorcism. And that show is 100 times better than The Lovers from Evil. Of course, you know, it has 6 episodes to develop its characters and all like that. But I think that was one of the things I really wish they would have done more, that they should have done a lot more character stuff with about Ralph Sarchi and stuff like that. I mean, I don't know why he couldn't be who he was. You know what I mean? They had to make up that whole entire story about how he was, trying to find, how he found his faith. When I thought it was a much more interesting movie if he was already into the work, as, you know, he called it, and how his fellow cops reacted to it, how they kind of looked down a little bit upon him about it, you know what I mean? I thought that would have been a much more interesting movie.
Yeah. So what are your final thoughts on it? Is it worth checking out, or would you want me to stay away?
I'm going to say video. If you get a Netflix or if you want to rent the old red box, I'd say it's worth that. I'd say it's worth the dollar rental, you know. If you want to spend a lot of money on, watching something like that, I would suggest you go out and buy the only season of Apparition. It's much better. But
Apparition is a great show. If you haven't seen that, you should check out that Apparition. I would say, since I'm such a snob about it, I would say go see it in the theater. And if you don't want to, go see it in the dollar theater, because I try to see movies, and they're better to see in the theater. But...
Yeah.
I would see it in the dollar theater. So
it's worth a dollar.
It's a fairly well done. It could have been a lot better, but it's not terrible.
It's,
So there we go. There's our thoughts there on deliver us from evil. So hopefully we'll get to read the book soon. And we'll see you next week, and I think Hercules is next week. So I think we'll be talking about Hercules.
Nice.
All right, everybody. See you next time.